So I want to thank you all for coming today, this afternoon, to Dr. Neil Roberts' talk, who will speak to us about his recent excellent book, Freedom as Marinage. And if you do not have a copy, we have provided flyers in the back that you can send in to get your copy at something of a discount. So you can look on the back table by the wall there. And he'll talk to us about his book as well as some other topics that I think prove of interest to many of us here today. I want to announce as well that this is the first in this year's DIASPORA Talk Speaker Series, which is sponsored by the L.Warfield Center for African and African American Studies. Although there will be ample publicity about the future speakers, the other three in the series will include Shana Redmond from the University of Southern California, who will join us on November 16th to speak about her book, Anthem, Social Movements, and the Sound of Solidarity in the African Diaspora. Quincy Mills, a historian at Vassar College, who will join us on February 15th to talk about his book, Cutting Along the Color Line, Black Barbers and Barbershops in America. And our final guest will be Cheryl Finley from Cornell University, whose talk is entitled, Restaging the Grand Tour, Routes of Contemporary African Diaspora Art. And Dr. Roberts was gracious enough to join and have a conversation with some of our graduate students earlier this afternoon. So I want to thank both Dr. Gordon and African Diaspora Studies Department, as well as Charles Hale and the Lozano Long Institute for Latin American Studies for helping provide the lunch that many of us enjoyed this afternoon. I also want to thank Dr. Cherie Smith, the L.Warfield Center's director, for asking me to organize this year's DIASPORA Talk series, as well as Stephanie Lang, the center's program coordinator, who helped me with the planning and make sure that all of the logistical concerns were attended to, especially to get today's talk in order. Dr. Roberts comes to us from Williams College, where he is the chair of religion and an associate professor of African studies and a faculty affiliate in political science. A former high school teacher, debate coach, and an NCAA Division I soccer player. I did not know.
Glory to you, they're all in.
Dr. Roberts brings an amazing background to his scholarship and professional activities. He has lectured nationally and internationally on a range of topics and has held a number of important professional positions. And I actually first encountered Dr. Roberts when we were graduate students, but had my first extended conversation with him at the Caribbean Philosophical Association meeting in Trinidad and Tobago a few years ago. And he has been on the board of directors for the Caribbean Philosophical Association, if I'm correct, since its inception. And he also chairs this publishing partnership with Roman and Littlefield International, where he runs two book series, one Creolizing the Canon, and the other is Global Critical Caribbean Thought. And this has already produced a rather excellent collection, Creolizing Rousseau, where he has edited this with Jane Anna Gordon, and this is where a number of people are thinking about Jean-Jacques Rousseau and bringing him into conversation with a number of Caribbean thinkers in a Caribbean context to some very excellent essays. And his intellectual output is quite amazing, so I'm not going to do any more culling from his expansive CV. But I want to jump right into the subject of his talk today by way of two quotes from prominent Caribbean thinkers that I believe get us on the way to thinking with Neil Roberts about freedom as marinage. The first quote comes from Frantz Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth, and this is kind of the famous closing that Dr. Roberts actually cited at lunch today. If we want humanity to advance a step farther, if we want to bring it up to a different level than that which Europe has shown it, then we must invent and we must make discoveries. For Europe, for ourselves, and for humanity, comrades, we must turn over a new leaf. We must work out new concepts and try to set afoot a new man. And the second is a less known quote from C.L.R. James. This is a statement that he made in a study group of Caribbean students in the late 1960s. The origins of our nation are the Maroons who ran away from the plantations and hid in the mountains. those that are the real originators of the Haitian nation, believe me. How we should think about these two statements, what they mean for how we think about freedom in the future world that many of us might want to bring into existence, remains one of the pressing questions of our contemporary intellectual and political moment. I want to suggest that Neil Roberts gets us well on the road to understanding how we might approach such a future by taking up, whether knowingly or not, the very question that James posed and that is implicit in Fanon's closing. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Neil Roberts.
Thank you for that gracious. Oh, we can do better than that. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am extremely honored and delighted to be here at UT Austin to deliver this year's first Diaspora talk, sponsored by African and African Diaspora Studies Department. But I do have a story that I don't think even our hosts know, which is, believe it or not, my first ever academic presentation was at UT Austin, in public presentation, rather, and it was in 1997. I fear if I ask when many of you were born, I will have to bow my heads and realize the gray hairs that I have in my age, but nonetheless, in April 1997, I attended a conference called the National Conference on Undergraduate Research, and I went into my archives and I looked at the title of the paper to remind myself, and here was that short title: Eric E. Williams, Racial Messiah or Hypocrite? A study of Black political leadership, race, and ethnicity in Trinidad and Tobago. End quotation. Pretty long title. I was accompanied by the director of a fellowship program that I had been a part of. And the audience was three people. You can look to your left and your right, and that would have been the entire audience. And I was an undergraduate, and I was crushed, because I'm thinking, you know, I'm bringing out the big crowd, right? But in the audience of three people, one of the persons who attended actually was from Trinidad and Tobago and had lived under Eric Williams' administration when he was alive. And so I learned a few things from my visit. One, that maybe I needed a shorter title. So freedom is mine. That's three words. Secondly, I learned a thing, correct me if I'm wrong, there's a thing called Bevo. Do you guys know about this? Bevo, still a mascot here, yes? Right? And I can't remember if it's like this or you know, what it was, so I meant Bevo when I was here. I also learned more seriously that it wasn't the amount of people who show up to an event, but the content, right, of the ideas discussed and the value that a particular presentation or collective reasoning has. And so hopefully today, in addition, not just with the talk, but also the question and answer, I'm hoping that we can have a discussion about what I believe to be a very important topic. But before beginning the formal talk, I do wish to say some thank you. First, a big, big thank you to Professor Minka Makalani for not only inviting me, but also being able to bring together all of us today for this event. To Tony Araguz, thank you for all of your help in planning the logistics for today. And also to Professor Juliet Hooker, who for several years has been not only a friend but a confidant in terms of those of us interested in the intersections of Black studies and political theory. So I'm very happy to not only see you here, but also your students. And finally, to all of you students and those who came for today. So what I want to do in my allotted time is to not simply talk about the book Freedom is Marinage, which I am assuming not necessarily anyone here has read, so I want to be able to say something about it, but I want to do four things in the process. The first, talk about why I wrote Freedom as Marinage. The second, to actually discuss the core claims of the book. And the next two are areas that I have I'm piloting here for the first time, so I'm admitting that. The third being discussing a debate in Black critical thought known as the Afro-pessimism and Afro-optimism debate. I want to be able to not only try and articulate the contours of what this debate is, but ultimately try and persuade you all that in many respects the philosophy of Maranao should very much implode the very terms of that discussion for a larger ideal that I hope us to have some understanding of. And whether or not I have time in the formal talk, the fourth, I want to talk about contemporary implications, particularly with regards to reparations for historical injustices, and lastly, the Black Lives, the How Black Lives Matter movement. Grace Lee Boggs, who was a close confidant and co-writer of several tracks with C.L.R. James, recently passed away at the age of 100. One of the texts that Grace Lee Boggs co-authored with C.L.R. James was entitled Facing Reality, right? Trying to understand what they called the new society, trying to imagine not only the world that we live in, but what type of world are we trying to forge? I think this is very much at the root of the Black Lives Matter movement. I think this is at the root of questions for reparations for social, for historical injustices. I think this is at the root of how we try and understand freedom. So to the first point of the talk, which is why I wrote this book. In the summer of 2001, I was preparing to travel to Chicago. I was living in Washington, D.C. at the time, and so I decided initially to drive to Chicago to move my belongings, and then I flew back. The individual who ended up being, or who was supervising my dissertation project, we had not met in person, only literally over email, had set up an appointment for us to meet on September 12th of 2001. Trying to stay as much time in Washington, D.C. as possible, I booked a flight from Reagan National Airport on September the 11th of 2001, or what we now call 9/11. Within a week of the travel permanently for graduate school, I received an email from my soon-to-be advisor saying a conflict had come up. Is there any way we could reschedule our meeting a day early? Meaning, have the meeting on September 11th of 2001, at which point I had to scramble to change my plane ticket, but I changed my plane ticket for September the 10th. However, my family did not know. Making a long story short, I have one sibling who's 4 years older, my sister, who all she had for me in terms of contact was a number for what would be my residence. And so on the morning of September 11th, my sister called me in the morning, very frantic, because she didn't know necessarily if I was alive or not. And so I picked up the phone to at least confirm I was alive, and I said, "Why are you frantic?" She said, "Turn on the television." And of course the rest was history. One thing I should add is the original, as far as my understanding, the original flight that I was supposed to be on from Reagan National was to have been in the trajectory of the plane that went into the Pentagon, which I do know some people who survived and other people who had died. In the wake of 9/11, a few things troubled me. The first, I felt like I was witnessing, and others probably here witness, an intensification of discourse that in some sense seemed to suggest that there were certain people that knew or valued freedom, and that there were other people, so-called non-Western peoples, who seemed to not either value freedom or understand what freedom means. Secondly, even for those who rejected that dichotomy, in terms of having discourse on what freedom means, I didn't see in a lot of the discussion in the wake of 9/11, the discussion of what we could call Afro-modern actors, different individuals from Africa and the African diaspora, who very much, in my view, had not only in the past thought about what it means to be free, but were also, at that moment, still trying to wrestle with the concept. And last but not least, I was troubled with the ways in which the relationship between slavery and freedom was not being discussed. I am a little older than many of you, not all of you, and I resisted this thing called Twitter. You guys know this thing? This thing called Twitter. It was like Instagram. I don't understand. You put a picture, but then people like it. So I feel like I understand Instagram. Twitter, I just didn't get. I understand Facebook. I understand other social media. But I do like Twitter. And so on Twitter, this morning, came across the following story from the New York Times. The caption of the story is, Texas. Publisher offers stickers to cover erroneous caption. The blurb reads, and this may be familiar to some of you instances, the publisher of a textbook criticized for an error that glossed over the topic of slavery has offered stickers to schools that will cover up a caption describing African slaves as quote-unquote workers. A spokesman said on Tuesday, a world geography textbook by McGraw-Hill Education was published in Texas this year and says in a caption about immigration that the Atlantic slave trade, quote, brought millions of workers from Africa to the southern United States to work on agricultural plantations, end quote. A Houston woman whose son noticed the mistake touched off a social media firestorm last week with posts on Facebook and Twitter. Changes have been made in the digital version of the textbook, the publisher said, adding that a sticker would be sent to cover the error for books currently in use. Dot. That is this morning. Okay. What is my point? My point is that even not just in that immediate wake of 9/11, but even right now, I don't want to just say this is Texas. Right? I think this is a larger problematic that I've been trying to wrap my head around in terms of not only our discourse and freedom, but also how slavery connects to it. So to the core claims of the book, I need you all a little call and response to do something with me. So we understand how a term works. I just want to use three times, we're going to say the word marinage together. We're going to say, so I'm going to say marinage. Marinage. Second time, marinage. Third time, marinage. There we go. The concept of marinage, what is this word that is actually a noun, but has the effect of a verb. I'll do very little reading today, but I do want to at least read one portion with regards to the idea of marinage. Marinage, spelled in different ways, conventionally refers to a group of persons isolating themselves from a surrounding society in order to create a fully autonomous community. And for centuries, it has been integral to interpreting the idea of freedom in Haiti, as well as other Caribbean islands and Latin American countries, including the Dominican Republic, Jamaica, Suriname, Venezuela, Brazil, Cuba, Colombia, and Mexico. These communities of freedom, variously known as Maroon societies, Quilombos, Palenques, and various other appellations, geographically situate themselves from areas slightly outside the borders of plantations to the highest mountains of a region located as far away from plantation life as possible. The term Maroon etymologically derives from vocabulary of indigenous Arawaks and Tainos in the Caribbean. The term initially referred to Spanish feral cattle in what was called Hispaniola, the contemporary polities of Haiti and the Dominican Republic. Spanish colonist cattle who then were fleeing to the hills. Many of you would recall a few years ago in Southeast Asia, there was a tsunami, right, that had hit Southeast Asia and hundreds of thousands of people perished. But you know we know, actually with GPS tracking, that a week before the tsunamis, they noticed that elephants were actually going, we have the tracking, that the elephants had sensed, right, that there was something that was going on and that they had gone up to the hills before that disaster. In terms of marinage, it initially referred to those Spanish colonists, field cattle going up to the hills, then to enslaved Amerindians in the period of transatlantic racial slavery, who were then fleeing to the hills and the marshes to escape plantation life, and then ultimately, in the early 1500s, to enslaved Africans seeking modes of escape from plantation life. Usually, marinage, when described by historians and anthropologists and even scholars of the Caribbean and Latin America, usually refers to two forms. The first, what is called petit marinage, which is just individual fugitive escape. So imagine an individual on a plantation either trying to escape just for a few hours, or imagine individuals trying to potentially organize an uprising between individuals on different plantations, or to see loved ones on another plantation. Individuals running away. And the second type, grandmarnage, G-R-A-N-D, which refers to territorially bounded, historically territorially bounded communities in which collectivities of persons try to create some type of space for collective living. In both of those models, the working assumption was that, and even in, particularly in that moment in time, was that the regime of plantation slavery would no longer in their lifetime or the immediate future ever be shattered. And so on the one hand, to not remain within the lowlands of the plantation, and yet at the same time not completely overturning the society, this was very attractive. But what's limiting, however, in how we conventionally refer to marinage as an idea of freedom. Marinage usually is pitted as either fight versus flight, or flight versus social and structure reorder. In essence, there are many who see marinage as a qualified conception of what freedom means. One thing that we know historically from the record, this was the case in the Caribbean, this was the case in Latin America, this was the case also in different regions of the world, but I would like us to think of the case of Jamaica with the rebellion called the Morant Bay Rebellion. The Morant Bay Rebellion was killed with a Maroon who then ended up capturing one of the two main leaders of the Morant Bay Rebellion, Paul Bogle, who was then executed. And the reason for that was the following. Historically, many Maroon communities were invaded by colonial powers and then repelled. Invaded by colonial powers and they repelled. Invaded by colonial powers and said, you know what? Let's stop the games. If a treaty can be signed by a Maroon community and a colonial power, the treaties stipulated most of the time that if any new runaways were to try and enter that territorially sovereign space, then they are to be turned over to the colonial authorities. And this was the case in the Jamaican Morant Bay Rebellion. But I want us to just pause and just think for a moment. If we were to actually imagine beyond historicity and actually think about freedom as the actual flight from different forms of enslavement, whether that is ancient Roman slavery, whether it is ancient Greek slavery, whether it is transatlantic racial slavery, whether that is now talking about the prison industrial complex or forced sexual workers, if we actually think about freedom as not simply purely physical forms of flight, but actually involving notions of distance, notions of movement, questions of property, and also our imagined purpose of what type of life we want to live in, then this changes the actual terrain of how we think about the idea of marinage. In addition, there are notions that have attempted to try and think about how marinage is related to this expansive idea, but have not quite been able to capture it. One of them is the idea of diaspora, right? The ways in which diaspora talks about different communities that have been dispersed, right, abroad from one's homeland. And so if we actually think about this, to comprehend a modified concept of marinage helps us to serve as a general political theory of freedom beyond its conventional Caribbean historical usage. One must first understand why the term to diaspora is fractionally useful, but not a panacea. Diaspora studies is a field forged in the 20th century as a result of inquiries into the migrations of peoples established or imagined. Diaspora is thus able to describe flight either unidirectionally, or for lack of a better analogy, flight and a return over time in a boomerang trajectory. So if you imagine a boomerang, right, that goes around this room, right, and then comes right back, right, into, right, comes back into a circle, there are ways in which that can be captured. Although it can describe elements of intrastate flight, including the great migration of African Americans from the south to the north, and Jamaican and Southeast Asian Maroons fleeing lowland states and plantation life in Highland, non-state spaces, in addition to flight across state borders, diaspora is unable to explain evanescent flight, modes of fugitivity, and interstate flight focused on the attainment of freedom through macro-level reorientation of civil society and state institutions, most notably revolutions. And so what I want us to be able to think through is, if we were to actually stretch how we think about the idea of marinages for those individual acts, those fleeting acts of fugitivity, to those isolationist communities, and then think about two other types of Maranatha, one which I call sovereign Maranatha. So imagine if we think at the mass level, what does it mean for a collectivity of people who do want social and political reordering of the society to occur, but they imagine their agency occurring through a single figure, some sovereign figure? We can think of that as a political leader. We can think of that as a deity or some other sovereign agency. But imagining our, in this room, our collective flight, our collective social and political restructuring occurring through the medium of one figure. In many ways, this is a top-down, trickle-down, right, model of what freedom should mean. And then, turning that valence over, imagine what we can call sociogenic Maranatha, which is a form of mass flight that is focused on revolutionary politics by the agents of the people themselves, right? Different modes of naming, different imaginings of the blueprint of what types of societies we want to live in. How do we imagine and create different modes of constitutions, and also the state of society? What is the relation between civil and political society? If we think about revolutionary politics, which is very much an aim of mine, then we have to reject this fight versus dichotomy. And then that really leads us to think, how then can we try and institute such a world? Okay, everyone with me thus far?
Yeah.
Okay. This I want to make sure everyone writes down as a thing. There are two alternative traditions that I contend in Western thought that encapsulate ways of thinking about freedom. I want to say first what they are, and secondly, what unites them despite their differences. The first tradition we can call negative conceptions of freedom, and the second tradition, positive conceptions of freedom. In the negative conception, there are different notions such as non-interference of one agent into another, or non-domination in civic republican articulations of this. But in essence, the negative stream is about how can we avoid some type of coercive agent, right, interfering or dominating our life. While that's useful, it doesn't tell us about what type of world we want to live in, what type of world we want to build, what Gracie Boggs says, the new, right, the new society. But it does tell us what type of world we don't want to live in, or what type of agent we don't want dominating or interfering with us. The positive tradition talks about notions such as self-mastery, notions such as autonomy, plurality, the general will. In the latter, we have different thinkers such as Hannah Arendt or Rousseau, who was mentioned, who actually differ over the question of sovereignty, but are similar in terms of the question of how do we actually participate in a polity. So we try to think about what type of world we want to live in, but it doesn't actually tell us, they don't tell us much about what type of world we want to avoid. What unites both of these, however, are two things. The first is that whatever unfreedom and freedom means, it's static, right? There's a sense in which you know what an unfree world is, and whatever the free world is very determined, and that it is static, it doesn't change. Secondly, it fails to address what in my view is actually the most important area, which is areas of liminality, right? Areas within individuals thrust within this, what Sylvia Winter calls kind of the liminal spaces within imagined unfreedom and freedom, or what Cornelius calls living in the funk, right? That most of us are actually in this, are actually struggling to attain some type of future world. And that, in essence, brings us to the idea of Maranatha, which is Maranatha is making a claim that, in fact, freedom is the process of flight itself. And that it's uniting these negative and positive streams together rather than simply rejecting them. So to the core claims of the book, and perhaps I'll start with the most controversial. The book makes an assertion that we are all humans are born enslaved. I'll say this one more time. The book is making a core claim that all humans are born enslaved, that enslavement is in fact the foundational human condition. Many of you may be kind of looking at me and saying, that just doesn't make any sense, I don't believe it. I've entertained the opposite conventional view, which is that we're all born free. And I actually think history is on my side, but that's actually not the case. But beyond that, I want to use a pop culture metaphor. And I know this is a movie's a little old, but just raise your hands. Who's seen the Matrix trilogy? Has seen the Matrix trilogy? It's on, I think now, YouTube or Hulu, or you should see it. But why do I mention this? I'll refresh your memory. The main characters in this series, the Matrix, especially the first one, you guys kind of saw this and remember this, right? There's an individual called Neo. So Neo's day job is as kind of a boring, you know, a job that he just thinks is boring, and it's in high-rise building, and he clocks in at 9 a.m., he clocks out at 5 p.m., he's got a nice suit, and iron, and does his job well. The real stuff gets interesting, right? After 5 p.m., because what? He has this other life as an internet addict, right? And there's something deep down that Neo thinks this well-ordered world just seems to be something's wrong. He doesn't know what's wrong. And then there's this other character called, you guys know his name, Morpheus. His name is Morpheus. Right? Who has the, I don't have the school glasses, you know, but the kind of the shades, right, the dark glasses. And he hears he needs to talk to Morpheus. Fast forward in the story, Neo meets with Morpheus. They're these really two comfy chairs, right? And they have a nice conversation about philosophical things in the world. And then ultimately Morpheus says, they're two pills. Okay? We're gonna have this nice, great conversation, and then you take this first pill, you'll forget everything that we just talked about, and you'll go back into La La. You take the next pill, he says, I'm not offering you anything except the truth. Okay? So Neo says, I'm taking the second one, right? We're gonna get to the root cause of this. He takes it, and then all of a sudden, he's like, something feels weird, and the room starts to bend and shift. And then all of a sudden, you see Neo's eyes get all crazy, and then ultimately, he wakes up into a ship called the Nebuchadnezzar, right? Which he realizes he's been in a machine world. And what do we learn even in those scenes? He sees that humans are being manufactured on what? Plantations, right? That machines. The machines are literally manufacturing humans on these plantations, and that being in the Matrix was literally the world, the ways in which he had been, from his manufactured birth, enslaved, and then had been put in this machine to, in some sense, interfere and dominate the very actions of people in it. And the question was, at that moment of going to Nebuchadnezzar was the first moment that disalienated consciousness came into being, and then, in some sense, he had his own form of Mara knowledge. I can talk more about different scenes between this and Frederick Douglass's discussion of Covey compared to Neo and the agent in one of the scenes in the train, but we can talk about that in the Q&A. But the important part is, if you were to actually think with me and entertain the idea that we're all born enslaved and that the process is freedom is the flight from that enslavement, then it also brings in the dimension I want to raise down, which is the psychological, right? That central to this narrative is not just a question of the physical and corporeality, our bodies. Right? It's also the question of the mind, right? The metaphysical. Not only our conceptions of religiosity and theism, but also our conceptions of the world beyond the physical and the ways in which the psychological is very central to our very understanding of what it means to be free. So when Rousseau says, man is born free and everywhere is enslaved, how can that be? First paragraph, part book one of the social contract. That's not a contradiction. Right? There is a way in which Bob Marley ripping off of Marcus Garvey, emancipate himself from mental slavery, none but ourselves can free our minds. It's about the ways in which, even without one's chains on one's hands, right? There's a way in which the psychodynamics of enslavement also allow those who themselves have no physical coercive or interfering dominating mechanisms on their body to actually still not live a free life, which then brings me to and prelude to the discussion of Afro-pessimism and Afro-optimism. This book, in the beginning, engages with a thinker known as Orlando Patterson, a Jamaican sociologist who in many respects, is probably the closest, at a certain point in his career, to many of the thinkings that I try and develop in the book, but his career took a shift. And the biggest shift is around a single book that Orlando Patterson published in 1982 called Slavery and Social Debt. And Patterson, on the one hand, did something that prior scholars of slavery and slave societies had not done in a successful way, which was to make the case that before Patterson's book, many people who studied, let's say, ancient Greek slavery, or even within the Athens, Athenian slavery and Spartan slavery, or transatlantic racial slavery, or the prison industrial complex, there wasn't a sense that you could understand or compare slave societies across time. And so Patterson enabled that type of analysis, but he fundamentally said one thing. He said, the psychology of the slave or slave societies had absolutely nothing to do with the activities of how a slave imagined him or herself. He fundamentally rejected the realm of the psychological as being relevant to the slave, and he developed a concept that he called the idea of slavery as social death. And what is social death? Social death for Patterson involved three principles. One, the idea of a slave as a powerless being, as a dishonored being. Thirdly, the idea of a slave as a natively alienated being, which is a fancy word to say from birth, right? Natality from birth, an individual is alienated from him or her self. The sum total of this, in my terms, not Patterson's, is that the slave is a zombie, right? Is a walking dead. The zombification, right? That slaves have no capacity. I want to be clear. Is everyone with me? That the slave in past, present, and future has no capacity for action, right? If a slave is able to have action, or if freedom is to come for the slave, it is from the master class who does it. So this is when you think of the question of manumission, the freeing of slaves. The question of abolition, emancipation. Even discussions, at the lunch we had a discussion of, very briefly, of the movie Lincoln, right? A discussion that doesn't talk about slavery at all, right? It's as if the commander-in-chief, right, was the only, right, one, an important figure, right? But it feels as if Lincoln was the only person to not talk about the struggle for the 13th Amendment, which actually still has not, right, prevented slavery from occurring with the duly convicted clause. My punchline is that if we think of, if social death is assuming that slaves have no capacity for agency, then this is very much in tension with the idea of Barnage, that is very much about the ways in which even if humans are intrinsically, or are born into a state of slavery, I'm making a claim, which I would love to hear your pushback if you disagree, that in fact, we're all intrinsically have the capacity for action. Our ability to enact forms of activity may be constrained, but you guys see the difference? It's a very different framework than actually saying we have no capacity for action. I draw very much upon Frantz Fanon, who I'll say more about momentarily, who in the beginning of his 1952 text, Black Skin, White Mask, said the Black Antillean was thrust into what he called the zone of non-being. He said the zone of non-being was a sterile and arid region in which an authentic, translation's a gender, but I would say better, an authentic upheaval can be born. Put differently, Fanon believed that it is our lived experiences in unfreedom that in fact, as arduous and as hellish as that life may be, it is that experience that actually provides the very terms for us to resist, right? It provides the very terms for us to imagine a world otherwise. And this is not a world in which we're socially dead. This is a world in which we have some challenges to try to attain that free life. Last major principle of Barnage before moving on. Emancipation does not equal freedom. Say it one more time. Emancipation, or in some other lexicons, independence, political independence, is not the same notion as freedom. While emancipation and political independence and different social and political orders is very much related to it, the process of freedom is something that is ongoing afterwards. This is why when individuals try and think about, even in US political history, well, how does one talk about freedom without denying forms of so-called, what W.B. Du Bois called, the meaning of progress in the souls of black people? If you think of different dates, 1965, at the end of the Civil War, where you think of the rise and fall of Reconstruction, where you think of the 1920s and 1930s, or the period of 1963, or as recent as Obama's election in 2008, there was a way in which each of those historical conjunctures were considered right, the struggle for freedom to be achieved. And then with those moments, social and political orders realigned. Not only can you achieve the world that you had imagined, you can also fall out of grace from that very world in which you had planned and tried to constitute. How do we actually talk about all of this together and the difficult ways in which we talk about it? I would suggest that Marinage allows us to provide a framework. And so, since I have, in terms of my remaining time, I just want to end with those third and fourth points with regards to, first, this debate called Afro-pessimism and Afro-optimism. And so I know there's, from undergraduates to graduate students to faculty and others, and so let me just try and spell this out in ways that may be translatable. I would probably say since the liberalism-communitarianism debate in political theory in the 1980s, no other debate, in my view, has led to such a large amount of commentary that has had so little result in any major change in terms of the actual types of goals it has. That was kind of a diss. That was a different way to say it. The debate really is like, I had a grand aunt once who talked about someone who I talk about, in case you haven't thought about it. And she said, you know, some people think that air is in short supply, so they just keep talking because they think the air is going to go. And in a lot of ways, these debates, in some sense, have people writing and blogging and responding and books and articles as if, you know, the context is in short supply to write, but it's unclear what the goal is. So let me talk about the camps. The first camp, Afro-pessimism. Afro-pessimism deploys, we need to talk about social death because Afro-pessimism deploys Orlando Patterson's notion as social death. And it makes a claim that if people in this camp, the scholars and activists in this camp, make the claim that the black body, right, the black woman, the black man, the black child, the actual black life is imbued with social death. So therefore, going back to Black Lives Matter, to questions of police brutality, to questions of certain dynamics that don't just echo slavery, but seem to be a reproduction of them, what Saidiya Hartman calls the afterlife, right, of slavery. Afro-pessimists make the claim that, in fact, drawing upon Patterson, that, you know, it's a very nihilistic tale, right? This is the way in which, this is an unfortunate, another mutation of the way the world is. But the strangest part of the Afro-pessimist camp is that the central thinker that is used in this camp to justify this is none other than Frantz Fanon. And in particular, Frantz Fanon's text that we mentioned earlier, the 1952 text, Black Skin, White Man. Now, many of you, or many of us all here, regardless of what you think of Fanon, I find Fanon one of the least pessimistic thinkers, not only of his period, but just in general. And so, what is, I think, problematic in this reading, not only to the idea of social death, because if you remember, we said social death is what? The belief that there are individuals, that they're the enslaved, have no capacity for action on their own. One of the things Fanon does in the seventh chapter of Black Skin, White Mask, entitled The Black in Recognition, is to actually suggest that the 1848 abolition decree in the Francophone world, right, by France to the Antilles, there was a way in which while there was a degree of emancipation, we said emancipation does not equal what?
Freedom.
That decree assumed by those who didn't struggle for freedom and were given emancipation, then thought the next move was to get some form of recognition by the former colonial power. Fanon says, Remember? He didn't have the term social death, but those social death people, right, they're telling you you're not agentic beings, and then if you've been granted your freedom or your emancipation, you're free, and you want recognition from them afterwards, don't drink Kool-Aid. Because that is going to lead to some of the worst future developments for one's life. Not only does this camp misrepresent Fanon's work, it doesn't talk about the rest of his work. Fanon wrote a book called The Dying Colonialism in the fifth year, was published in 1959, the fifth year of the Algerian Revolution, where Fanon initially was in Algeria, though he had to go to Tunisia for political reasons, where he was initially before them working in a hospital to talk about how, in terms of a psychiatric war, to challenge different forms of French colonial medicine. He also, his last work, Le Damné de la Terre, or The Wretched of the Earth, better translated as The Condemned of the Earth, was very much a blueprint for how a sociogenic blueprint for how a mass collectivity of people can then try and not only overthrow a system, but try and imagine the forms of constitutionalism and the reworking of social and political orders in the wake of it. In between those two major works, Fanon has different works that were published posthumously, collected in Towards the African Revolution, one being Racism and Culture, where Fanon was trying to figure out how do we reconcile different forms of racial discourse and anti-racist discourse with the valence of right culture. How do those come together? And then other works in between. This is beyond Fanon. Afro-pessimist camp. Afro-optimist camp say there's hope in the unseen. We should have hope. Ta-Nehisi Coates, many of you probably read Between the World and the Great by Ta-Nehisi Coates, a recent book, in which there's a way in which he writes a letter to his son about the kind of anti-black police violence, and yet there isn't a sense necessarily of hope. And yet the Afro-optimists, the second camp, seem to suggest there is, should be some hope for what scholars like Fred Moten call stolen life, the stolen life of black subjects in the modern period. However, the camp still does not undo this belief in social death as being a foundational state of the DNA, and it doesn't really offer a blueprint to the future. So if we are looking to the future in my closing moments, and I really do want this to be a conversation, then how do we think about this future world? In the book, I try and engage with a selection of thinkers and movements, among them Hannah Arendt, Philip Pettit, Frederick Douglass, Angela Y. Davis, Edward Glissant, the Haitian Revolution, and also the book ends in its afterword with the Rastafari movement. It doesn't work linearly in terms of time, but it tries to think about how we can draw upon some of the lessons of these thinkers and these movements. But beyond those figures, there are two developments that I want to leave us with that I think try and address this question of what freedom may mean for all of us here today in a moment of great strife and continued debate. The first is the issue of reparations for historical injustices, and second, the Black Lives Matter movement. First, I want us to get some clarity on what reparations means. And I want you to know, what does reparations mean? Two principles are central to a reparations claim. The first, a public apology for a historical injustice by an individual or body associated with having instituted a historical injustice on another agent or community. And the second is compensation or / rectification. Many times when people hear reparations, especially in the North American context, they think, what? Cash money, right? But that's not what reparations mean. Right? Compensation, there are models of reparations that are about, right, financial transactions, so to speak. But the larger issue is, right, rectification. How can there be not only an apology, the ways in which in the post-colonial period or the post-apartheid period, there are certain forms of historical injustices that were not reckoned with. In the Jamaican context, there is a double complexity. For those following the news, the past week, the British Prime Minister David Cameron was on an official state visit to Jamaica. One of the biggest issues that came up during that official state visit was, unsurprisingly, the reparations for historical injustice. I'm going to give you what Cameron did. He tried to flip the script in a way that even I didn't even expect. So not only did Cameron actually not want to talk about reparations claims that the British state, as a former colonial power over Jamaica, should have to not only publicly apologize, but also have some form of rectification or compensation, Cameron actually laid out a blueprint for the building of a massive state-of-the-art prison. Did anyone hear about this? And this is connected to a phenomenon of what are called the deportees. So one of the things that the British government has done over the last several years is persons of Jamaican, who are deemed of Jamaican descent, who may have been accused of a felony, the British state in the last several years has intensified, literally deporting individuals from the UK who are British nationals to Jamaica, whether or not they even know any of their relatives or their descendants on the island. So Cameron actually proposed, in addition to not wanting to address the reparations issue when it was brought up in the state visit, he actually proposed the building of a new prison that in some sense could not only accommodate the deportees, but also the post-colonial Jamaican state. The second complexity with regards to reparations for historical injustice is with regards to the Rastafari movement. The Rastafari, though, has different branches, just like different other world religions, have made reparations claims not only vis-a-vis the British state, but also the post-colonial Jamaican state as well. The Rastafari really see themselves as a 20th century Maroon movement. One of the complexities, in addition to the first two that were just mentioned, about the 21st century is how does one actually have a disposition of a Maroon philosophy when it is inevitable to avoid the state? Right? At one point, there are different communities that could carve out their own spaces within the state, but what does it mean when one has to actually interact with the state? And in after independence in 1962, the then Prime Minister, Alexander Bustamante, had then ordered the massacre of several Rastafari in the area called Coral Gardens. And so these different claims have been made by the Rastafari movement. One of the things that differentiates different reparations claims are whether or not those who experience historical injustice are living or deceased. But nonetheless, there is this larger claim, getting back not only to the physical, but also to the psychological, in terms of how is freedom simply at the emancipation moment or the independence moment. And I'll end with the second, which is more for the conversation, which is Black Lives, how do Black Lives matter? This may hit home to many of you, or if not, at least is something for us to discuss. What does it mean in 2015, in the period of the cell phone, the videos, it almost seems every day or every other day there's something that is caught on tape about not only the relationship between citizens, right, to black citizens, to the police as a representative of the state, the legacy of not only white supremacy, but in Baltimore, which is, many people a lot of times talk about Baltimore, the uprisings in Baltimore and Ferguson as if they are completely comparable. In Ferguson, with the death of Michael Brown, this was a space in which a majority black citizenry or population was numerically asymmetric to a white elites in power, whether that was in the actual police force itself, city council, and other areas. In Baltimore, this is a city that at the moment of the uprising, the recent uprisings, has a black mayor, black head of the police force, black head of the city council, and various other institutions. So the question in terms of blackness and anti-blackness is the following, is simply what Fanon called one's phenotype, a mode of solidarity, or are there ways in which mutations in terms of questions of white supremacy, or what Zora Neale Hurston said, my skin folk are not necessarily my kinfolk, right? Are there ways in which there's a formal logic of association that either enables or tries to have a retreat from the actual ossification of freedom in our late modern times. The Black Lives Matter movement has been organic, in some cases decentralized, in other spaces increasingly centralized, but still the larger claim remains. How do we actually think about black life in our current moment? How do we think about those who were born enslaved, who themselves had different forms of progress, but still find that freedom that was imagined has not yet materialized? And how do we actually have a series of goals beyond simply the Afro-optimism, Afro-pessimism, right, debate? How can we not just have a debate, but how can we actually think about a concrete form of human living and realize that even when we achieve our goals, there's still more challenges to be met? I think my formal time is up so that we can actually have a question and answer period. But thanks for listening to us.
Sure. Political thought. But I wanted to see if you could kind of enlighten me on the difference between metaphysics and psychology. Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's a great question. One of the discussions that I talk about, and hopefully this is more the last, the last form of marinage that I introduced, the idea of sociogenic marinage, which was an attempt to try and think about how can we have mass revolutionary politics that is orchestrated by a collectivity of people, not just through leaders. And the question is, how do you attain it? If there are even different questions in terms of our naming practices or the relationship between civil society and political society and constitutionalism, those are certain important factors. But one thing I talk about in the book is a term I call Veve architectonics. And so Veve is a central term, an essential notion in Haitian voting. And it refers to different pictograms within kind of the Haitian, kind of, within that particular belief system, in which if one imagines a supreme being and then having different deities that are not different gods but representations of that being, there are representations used with cornmeal and put on the ground, and then there are different rituals, in some sense, to not only augur that different deity, but also different forms of ancestor worship for those who believe in this particular worldview, which is, I would say, a metaphysical worldview. So I'm going to come back to that in a moment. But I wanted to imagine, how do we actually talk about not only individuals who have a particular form of, whether it's actually being a part of a particular religious tradition or theological worldview, and those who don't, right? Who don't actually have a sense of a certain type of universal order, but are still trying to imagine what type of world we want to live in. And so that really raises this kind of question of the relationship between metaphysics and psychology. And so for me, in terms of metaphysics, that first notion is the relation of not only beyond the physical, it's thinking about both the kind of the theistic worldviews and also different notions beyond the physical that people may have outside of religious traditions. And then the question of psychology, which involves both not only that, those larger worldviews, but also things in the physical world that may impact us. So one of the things I talk about in the book that then relates to the Matrix is the following. Have any of you read Frederick Douglass's Narrative of the Life of Frederick Douglass, 1845? Frederick Douglass, so the first narrative, very short, punchy text, taught in many even high school systems. Douglass had three autobiographies. There are many who read the first, written while Douglass was still a fugitive, and then he then went 18 months to Great Britain afterwards on the run. And then people usually say, if you want to read another autobiography, skip to the last, The Life and Times. It was after the end of the Civil War. You'll learn more about Douglass's life, and you can skip over the middle. But the middle autobiography, I really wish all of you could read it if you haven't. It's called My Bondage and My Freedom, published in 1855, before the outbreak of the Civil War, and is still one of the most radical texts, which gets at your question. And so there's a famous scene, not only in that text, but in all of Frederick Douglass's autobiography called The Fight with Covey. The short version is Douglass was a slave in Maryland, and at a certain point he was deemed to be unruly. And so there was a slave, there was an individual named Edward Covey who slave masters in our 21st century term, outsourced their slaves to Covey to basically break them, and then some months later send them back to the plantation so they will never be unruly again. Why do I mention this? It was only by accident that I noticed when I was going through the middle autobiography and researching this book, that I noticed throughout the book that Douglass inserted the word comparative or comparatively in similar passages that were retold in the first narrative. And so I thought it was just, maybe I'm just making this up. And then I would say the fight with Covey next to What to the Slave is the 4th of July speech of 1852 is probably the most discussed aspect of Douglass's entire body of work. And one of the things I trace in the book is that next to the central discussion of this book, when Douglass initially just had the word freedom in the narrative, he adds the word, without brackets, comparative to it. And in essence, this fight with Covey was a 2-hour fight where at a certain point, so this is where I liken it to what I call the neo-moon. This is a moment in which Douglas had been beaten by Covey. He was sick of being beaten. And then at a certain point, Covey says something, and then Douglas turns around, and then he rolls up his sleeves, and he decides he and Covey are going to have it out. Kicking, right there, fighting. Have you seen, the Matrix, the first Matrix? For those who've seen it, this would be likening to the scene when Neo goes, you know, he's in the subway station, right, with the agent. And then there's a point in which, right, because in the film, right, to be able to get out of the Matrix, then you have to get a call, right? And so people usually say, if you see an agent, Morpheus says, run, right? And this is where they say, run, Neo, run! And then what does Neo do? He turns around, and what does Morpheus say?
He's starting to believe.
Right? And then they duke it out, they're kicking it out, Neo's going against the wall, and they're just kicking the agent to the wall, right? And then ultimately, the battle, not the war, Neo wins the battle, right? But then what happens to the agents, right? They reboot, and then he runs, right? To your psychology question. In what I was able to trace in the book is that Douglas adds unbracketed, the word comparatively, where he says, after this 2-hour fight, he says, Covey could no longer, right, could no longer, in other words, Douglas then writes, after that 2-hour fight, he might have been, he says, a slave in the law. But in reality, in his mind, right, what I call the fact-form distinction, he then says, I was a freeman, right, he uses his fact-form language to actually say that actual 2-hour fight, at the psychological level, let Douglas know that even though juridically in the law, he wasn't emancipated in the law, but the power that Covey had over Douglas, just like the power that the agent had over Neo after that fight, there was a mutation. Is this making sense, everyone? There was a mutation in a so-called alienated individual who themselves were, and herself were, intrinsically had the capacity for action, but because of social and political orders of enslavement, were deluded, or what Sartre calls were in bad faith about their intrinsic capacity for change. Douglas, like Neo, starts to believe that the world could be otherwise. So getting to the last point, metaphysics-psychology distinction. Metaphysics is beyond the physical, whereas psychology, which includes questions of discussions of metaphysics, is not just limited to that. This is starting to be clear why the distinction between social death is important. Because the social death position says, and Patterson says it in several texts, not just that larger work, that psychology has no relevance in the actions of a slave. And Douglas's text, when he adds the word comparatively, he's saying he recognizes that that fight didn't make him entirely free, but it was what? It was on the road to freedom. I'm hoping I answered your question, but this sense in which that psychology, I'm really trying to orient us to say that there is a way in which both the physical and the metaphysical relate to not only our capacity to realize our intrinsic action, but also the world in which we're trying to, build. And that autobiography, the second one, doesn't give the entire roadmap of the world, but it does give a sense of a shift. And without giving away the book, I suggest that the radicalism of Douglas before the advent of the Civil War, he abandons the radicalism of that text when essentially Douglas becomes a politician later in life. But your question is an important one. And I think that discussion of the fight with Covey, there's nothing particular about Douglas, but that point that Douglas makes, I think, drives it. Please.
First of all, thank you. Really compelling. One of the things that people talk about when they're talking about concepts of liberation. Within the African diaspora, particularly the tradition of Manaj, is its tendency to be hyper-masculinized. And so I would like to see if you could comment on that and talk a little bit about gender.
Yes.
How gender either disrupts or fits into this conversation.
That is really important, and I want to focus mainly on your point in terms of the hyper-masculinized discourse, but also I want to say in that discussion on the relationship between liberation and freedom. So one of the figures who I write about in this book, and also who's increasingly been someone who I continue to write about is a scholar activist, Angela Y. Davis. And I have been very interested in not only Davis's observations, particularly to Douglas, from not only the period when she gave her two lectures on liberation in 1969, she's a visiting philosophy professor at UCLA, all the way through our current moment. Douglas has been, I read, one of the 2 to 3 central figures that Davis has written about. But Davis herself, in 2010, wrote a foreword to one of the new editions of The Narrative of the Life of Frederick Douglass, which actually talks about the ways in which even her own language from the 60s itself was reproducing a form of masculinist conception of what it means to be free. And so one of the things I try and talk about, not only in the book, but also just with us in our discussion here, beyond the book, is the ways in which, I take very seriously a lot of the observations and works in terms of intersectionality. One understands the idea of intersectionality, particularly coined by Kimberly Crenshaw, but also different thinkers, even as most recently as Melissa Harris Perry, that suggests that if the human being is not simply made up of one form of identity, but actually that different forms of identity from race, gender, sexuality, sexual orientation, age, and other measures impact the ways in which not only impact our actions in the world, but also impact our interactions in the world, then in discussions of freedom, we need to actually be able to talk about the ways in which a lot of these, not only just the language of freedom, but the interlocutors who we talk about or who one looks to within different traditions, put up a theory, but also within a kind of African, within Africana thought. And so Davis has been very interesting to me in terms of not only meditating on her own writings with regards to the question of kind of gender and the ways in which gender structures different discourse on freedom, but also one of the discussions I had in the book is what I call proto-constituent assembly. So a lot of the discourse on the Haitian Revolution or the revolution in Saint-Domingue in the 20th century and even the early 21st has very much been conditioned by C.L.R. James's book, The Black Jacket. I don't know how many have read that text. It was originally published in 1938 and then republished with an afterword in 1963. And so the text is the story of the Haitian Revolution through the figure of Toussaint, right, L'Ouverture, who undoubtedly was a major figure in the revolution, but much of the discussion of the revolution, not only with James, is really a discussion of different black and brown men, in terms of not only Toussaint, Dessalines, Christophe after the revolution, and others. And so one of the facets I try to talk about in the book is that there was a period, historicism is a little difficult to understand, but in essence, there was a period in which the French Revolution began in 1789, the Haitian Revolution began in 1791, the Haitian Revolution ends formally in 1803, but there was a brief period in which there was a decree by France that there was no longer slavery to be functioning on the island. A brief period before Napoleon becomes emperor. In that moment, in terms of demands about what type of world should an ex-plantation life be in, there were different assemblies of enslaved, temporarily formally enslaved black women, who then actually had assemblies, or what C.L.R. James and Grace Lee Boggs would have called basically a council system. So there were assemblies in which different enslaved black women, also women of color, that met, or formerly enslaved, met to then think about what should be different debates from the question of pay to various other policy issues that were to be addressed and meted out. With the reinstitution of slavery, many of those imagined debates did not come to fruition, but the actual, not just the stories, but the actual actions of these women who were talking about different issues at that moment that many times are written out of Haitian revolutionary scholarship, those were one of the things I was trying to capture. But one can think of different examples, but I guess the punchline of this is that absolutely, if we're to understand what freedom is, we have to understand the multiple valences of what structures the human being and also our interactions with others that very much impact this discourse. So let's go back to Black Lives Matter. So Black Lives Matter has overwhelmingly done a lot of discourse to talk about, right, police killings of young black boys. Who are the founders of Black Lives Matter? How many?
Two.
Three, right? And not just black women, but also LGBTQ, right? Black women, in terms of these are the founders of the movement, and there is this irony, which is not necessarily an irony, one thinks about the question of intersectionality and the disavowal of it, that yes, it is a decentralized movement, but the ways in which the actual founders themselves were asserting, not just by their bodies, but also the actual principles of what was being called for as a social movement, an intersectional framework that was trying to think of whatever the ideals of Black Lives Matter should be, has to take into account the multiple valences of the human condition. So before really, you know, before the case of Sandra Bland and some other cases, really a lot of the discourse was focused on Mike Brown, I mean big cases, Mike Brown, Trayvon Martin, in retrospect, and others. And so this is not your question is not something just of the past, this is something, that's what I'm trying to get across, which is that this is with us, you know, right now, if we're really serious about what freedom means, which is not to be confused with the question of liberation, which is related to it, then we actually have to talk about not only just the hyper-masculinized, but the gender dimensions of enslavement. My understanding is there are also students here taking a class right on gender and enslavement. So this should not be understood as simply something of a previous century, but that this is something that is a struggle right in this current moment. That's an important question. Maybe you see first telling me and then.
So on the topic of reparations,
yeah.
So the first argument is that it's a public apology for historical injustices, and the second part of reparation is the compensation or the ratification of the wrong, right? So a lot of people have argued that reparations would seem to signify that the injustices have already ended, but what would the response be to like things such as the prison industrial complex right now, of these ongoing historical injustices that can't be accounted for in terms of reparations? So how can we give a reparation, but also combat the institutional challenges right now in the status quo?
Yeah.
And why would reparations become a form of like a ruse of solvency to those issues as well?
Yeah, these are really great points. And so I'm going to use two examples, the United States and South Africa, if I may. So in the U.S. case, there are more than a few issues, but a few that come to mind. The first is, regardless of what any of you believe about reparations as an idea, there is many times a discussion of if reparations are to be taken seriously, some believe that it can only be with regards to people currently alive or currently in this world who experience the alleged historical injustice. So when individuals talk about reparations for the Holocaust, reparations for Japanese Americans who were interned within the United States, and other claims, some say, well, even if I were in favor of reparations for the historical injustice of transatlantic slavery, the deceased are the deceased, so how can we actually talk about it? We can't have a conversation. The second is, for those who are arguments against, and I think Adolf Reed has attempted to make this, Adolf Reed Jr., who is kind of a prolific black political scientist, who has made strong arguments against reparations claims, and the following argument goes something like this, which is whatever reparations, public apology, and rectification happens, at that moment, should anything in the future happen that indicates some type of afterlife of enslavement, there can be no actual attempt to try and make claims on the state, because hey, reparations, right, would have been meted out. So therefore, one should not do it. Okay. First thing. To the question of pillar two of reparations. The first is the public apology. The second is how do you have a form of compensation or rectification? Because there are many empirical social scientists who have tried to render reparations in some sense. So what's the cost of black life, right? How do you actually, is there a number, right? Is there a number to that? That's the money balance. But I actually want to push us to think about the question of programmatic, meaning programs. And I don't mean simply there have been debates. I know the state of Texas continues to have a debate with regards to affirmative action. I think I'm right about that. There are some who made the case that programs such as affirmative action are could be considered within a reparations claim, but one can understand different forms of compensation for historical injustice that may not necessarily, it's possible, like the Reed point may be true, that after the institution of a form of reparations for historical injustice happens, then it doesn't solve all of the imagined significant ills of the past, but the question ends up becoming, So what about the present? What about the continued, right? The continued afterlife of enslavement and the lack of the state's attention to try and address it. Second model, South Africa. There was a phenomenon called the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Raise your hands if you're familiar with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And that's what I thought. Many are not. So in the South African case, after the end of apartheid, which was the name for the white supremacist state of South Africa, South Africa took what seemed to be a moral and political move that no other major modern state has taken, including the United States, which was based upon a philosophy in South Africa called Ubuntu. And in essence, under the end of apartheid, if one in a space such as this, in a public forum that was recorded, if one publicly confessed their complicity with apartheid, whether that was the massacre of, if one individual massacred, shot 1,000 black or colored youth, or if it was simply one did nothing to prevent the ongoing structure of the apartheid state, publicly confessed one's involvement in a public space, then afterwards, the idea was right, you wash away, right? The sins, the country needs to move on. Right? Well, what's the complexity with South Africa? Because that wasn't a move towards a demand for reparations for historical injustice. In the post-apartheid moment in which, and District 9 in science fiction, as a science fiction version of trying to understand the sense in which the shanties, right? The shanties have not only been around the same numbers, in some cases have proliferated under black leadership. How then, you guys think, how then does one talk about the rectification for the afterlife of the actual state that has black leadership in terms of ownership, in terms of capital, right? In terms of question of capital? Percentage-wise, whites in South Africa still own the same percentage of not just land, different companies, various others, asymmetric to the actual size of the state. And so there's a question of, well, reparations, it's hard to have that discourse because there was already the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. There's some of you will hear about it called the TRC. That's the short name for it. So we are in a moment, and I want to say not just in the US, but I want to also talk about the Jamaican case as well, which is that there is this sense in which, for those who are making these claims, I realize reparations is not going to be an issue that all will agree on, but for those who are advocating for it, it's an attempt to try and figure out, not just in terms of monetary compensation, but what types of programs might help to then, let's now go back to sociogenic marnage. If one of the pillars is the kind of balancing of individuals in civil society vis-a-vis the state, then what are the ways to best try and accomplish that for individuals who have been excluded, not only from the state apparatus, but also different civil society institutions? It's a great question. I know there was a hand in the back. Yeah.
All right, I wanted to ask you about the connection between freedom and sovereignty.
Yes.
And hopefully maybe I can connect this to the earlier question about the masculinist ideas that underpin notion of freedom as one of sovereignty or independence. Mm-hmm. And you brought up the Jamaican Warren case and brought up the fact that they had a treaty and had to return escaped slaves and also were helped to put down slave rebellions.
Yeah.
In Jamaica.
Yeah.
And I just wondered if in your book you look at Caribbean discourses of non-sovereignty or nested sovereignty. I think Jari Bonilla talks about this, about the fact that the idea that Peru is just isolated and didn't have to deal with the state. And, necessarily sure people use this to talk about in the French Caribbean about nested forms of sovereignty, because they're not actually independent states many times. So Guadeloupe and Martinique are still
departments
of France. And so there's this ongoing discussion about if freedom is sovereignty, we get sovereignty, that actually lets the colonizer off the hook. And the colonizer can say, we gave you your freedom, now you're responsible for yourself. And that's actually have a relationship of getting some reparation, and have the sovereignty actually nullify that. So I wondered if there's some discussion of problematizing the relationship between freedom and sovereignty, which is a universal.
Yeah, so one facet of the sociogenic modernizing model that I didn't mention is non-sovereignty. So there is a notable part of the book that is actually rejecting the claims to sovereignty. And by sovereignty, I mean not just the question of the nation state or the world after the Treaty of Westphalia that sees sovereignty in terms of territoriality, but also different aspirations to the sovereign life. So going back to the sovereign modernizing model, the idea of even thinking of our collective freedom through one type of a figure. You are raising the territorial sovereignty question. I had attended, and maybe others here had attended, a meeting of the Caribbean Studies Association. This was about 4 years ago, three or four years ago, and it was in Guadeloupe, which for those who aren't familiar, Guadeloupe and Martinique are what are called departments. So they're French overseas departments. So essentially they're like saying Hawaii and Alaska, that they're actually states of the larger polity, even though they're not contiguous to the mainland of the United States. Guadeloupe, Martinique, not contiguous to mainland France, but a state within. It is a domestic flight to go from the capital of Guadeloupe to Paris. It is an international flight requiring a visa to go from Antigua to Guadeloupe, which is a 10-minute flight. The theme of the Caribbean Studies Association meeting of the year was on nation states and sovereignty. And there were many people on the program who then didn't make it to their panels because they had visa issues. I kid you not, there was even a discussion when I got to customs in the airport in Guadeloupe, where I had a discussion of HIV/AIDS, in particular to Haitians. So they had a discussion of like, Haitians. We have to be, want us to be aware, you know, the translation of HIV/AIDS, and I said, what? And they had Haitians, and I said, oh man, this is relating to the, not only relation of Caribbean states to colonial powers, but also the internal politics of questions of sovereignty within the region that are very much tied to the afterlife of slavery. So one of the central facets of freedom is modernized is to actually think about how we can talk about non-sovereign modes of organization. So this is why I won't say I end and conclude, but the afterword is on the Rastafari movement. So one of the, what I try and do is actually talk about it. And this is not a romanticization of Rastafari, but Rastafari, one of the branches known as the Bobo Shanti. So when people think of Rastafari, many people think, one, they think locks, right? Well, there's a few things I think some of you probably think when you think of Rastas. But one of them, if you actually look at different, I'll just take that left as you know what I'm talking about. Though the world is changing on this particular issue, right? But one of them is if one sees Rastas who have one's head in a turban, wrapped in a turban, so if you think of different dance hall artists, Sizzla, Capleton, Junior Reed, those are members of branches are called houses. Or mansions called the Bobo Shanti, Bobo Ashanti, who believe that one should not have their locks shown in public except with one's family and one's commune. The Bobo Shanti, though, are the most garbage of all of the different branches. So even on the questions of reparations and repatriation, meaning if one thinks that they're enslaved in Babylon and the Jamaican state is in some sense Babylon in the new so-called New World, then how can one return home, so to speak, whether that is Ethiopia or part of Africa? And so the Bobo Shanti are the only branches of the Rastafari that have done something that not only Gargates but other branches of the movement have, which was many branches, rightly so, had rejected before the formation of the United Nations, but was in the League of Nations, right, which under Kantian cosmopolitan principles were supposed to be these universalist enlightenment ideas of freedom and reason and justice. And then when we Italy invaded Ethiopia in the 1930s, Western powers didn't do a single thing, right? Under those so-called cosmopolitan principles. So Marcus Garvey in 1920, the Garvey movement had a document called the Declaration of Rights of Negro Peoples of the World, which in some sense was a kind of series of principles for the black internationalist world, of which some of the discussions were with regards to reparations and freedom of the seas. However, the Bobo Shanti said, in all those decades after the 1920 document, after the League of Nations, after the formation of the UN in 1948, where is all this reparations discourse? What have been the results? So, the Bobo Dreads have decided, you know what? If the 1948 Declaration of UN Declaration of Human Rights is the key juridical document for those who are interested here in becoming lawyers or international law, the key principles, Bobo Shanti have actually used particularly two clauses of the UN Declaration of Human Rights, one with regard to the right of stateless peoples, and secondly with regard to the question of nationality, which in essence deterritorializes nationality with birthright, right? Which then provides the term, they've made an argument to say, if one believes that they, one's real homes, let's say Ghana or Ethiopia or another place that is not Jamaica, then through the UN Declaration of Human Rights, they've been making this advocacy outside of the question of territorial sovereignty. One believes one's people are dispersed, right, people across the world because of forced enslavement. Then to try and respond to the effects of that forced enslavement in one's imagined view of freedom, in this sense, I'm suggesting requires, does it make sense? It requires us to not only get out of the framework simply of just nation state as the realm of freedom, but also the question of sovereign. And again, not to romanticize the Rasta, and I believe the person asked the question had to leave, but the question in terms of the hyper-masculinization of the language of freedom, one of the biggest critiques of the Rasta movement has been the question of not only masculinism, but what are the roles of women in the movement? And this is something that needs to be addressed. And so part and parcel even of that critique is to suggest that even the Rastafari movement in its areas of critique that we should be trying to uphold, the philosophy of Martin Eisner saying that even that movement has to undergo its own mutations. And all of this is with regards to questions of non-sovereignty. And it probably makes sense why in the book, I say this book, Martin Eisner is not anti-Western, I say but post-Western in the introduction. And that's why Hannah Arendt is actually very influential in my thinking, because Arendt, for a period stateless Jewish immigrant to the United States who had fled Nazism, was very much concerned with how many people collapse the idea of freedom into questions of sovereignty. And so if one were to actually think about freedom beyond notions of sovereignty, then I think that Martin Eisner offers us a way to think this through. Thanks for the time.